the lives of those men and women who have made a legacy, who have contributed a lot into the Zimbabwean industry, is what we do right here on The Legends. And on today's show, we have managed to reach out to one person who was behind the producing of more than 100 artists. Can you imagine the likes of Oliver Mtukudzi, Simon Chimbetu, Kiyama Boys, Jerema Boys, Masha Munumungu, and the Four Brothers, among his others. They are countless, you name it. So we want to meet this guy. Let's go out of the studio and begin the stage.
As a trainee, I did quite a lot of, I worked with the Rusike Brothers, you know, Rising Power, Same Age Boys. And then when I joined Grammar, the first record I did was just after independence, was Makoro Koto from Four Brothers.
Oh, okay, Okay. I think I did.
That was the first that I sat there as an engineer, though. That was just very nerve-wracking. They were a big band.
Of course. Like,
what if I messed this up? Yeah, but it was there.
Okay. So, I understand you've worked with many artists. I would want to mention some of these guys: Thomas Mapumi, Oliver Mtukudzi, Simon Chimbetu, among his others. No, I'll mention them. So these guys, you know, there is System Tanzila, there is Leonard Jembo, Jonah Moyo. A lot of these big names. Tell me the secret behind this.
Well, I think when I joined Grammar Records, these guys already contracted. Most of them are really contracted to Grammar Records. But I mean, when you are new in any field, people are very skeptical, you know what I mean? So when I started, I can't name the artist, but when one artist came in and saw me, because they were so used to seeing the guys that were there before, like Steve Roskill, Martin Norris, doing the recordings. So when they saw me, I was still a young guy then, they saw me sitting behind the desk, they were worried. It was also giving them pressure and also putting me under pressure that I've got to match up to these guys. But these guys were always there to help. They always telling me, say, okay, let's do this. But it was very, very interesting.
I still have got so many questions now. I'll have to ask you this after the break.
Okay.
Working with so many, more than 100, I just can imagine. You know, something great.
Thank you. neseka chichi Rudo chete rudo nineta Usani uonese nino penge Kana dada munu inini Ngamuda opacho kwadi mudio wangu Usani uoneseka chichi Chichi Rudo chacha runo nineta Usani uoneze nino penga Kana dada munu inini Damu dao bacho kwadi mudio wangu Usani uoneze kachichi Rudo chacha runo nishunguruta Runo chansa ukarafasi Dika swera ndisi na kukuona Zino ndi waza oba moyo
to the second segment of Legends. Say, can I ask you something?
Yes.
Can you compare yesteryear music to today's music?
Well, there's been so many eras and technology has been changing ever since the recording machine was invented. Mm-hmm. And, well, good music is good music. I can't say I can compare, like, this is better, this is worse, but any good music will still do very well. It doesn't matter what age, what technology you're using. If it's a good song, people like it. Because the main aim is to try and please the people and make hits. So if you can make hits today, it's good. Maybe if you do it better than what we used to do before, then you say, okay, maybe the technology has helped. But I don't think that's the case. Technology does help improve the and enhance the sound. And I think the music, you can rule out the musician and the writing of the music itself, the skill of writing the songs themselves. And that actually governs what music is better and what music is not better. But it doesn't matter, it can be reggae, it can be sumbura, it can be dancehall, it can be anything, rock, whatever. It does not change. It's just how you write the music.
But is it affected you in any way?
Not really, because I've continued working with what I was working with before. Obviously, I won't understand the modern lingo that these youngsters talk about, so I'll miss out on that. So I'll rather concentrate on the more traditional thing that I'm used to, and I find it much easier to relate to the artist in that way.
So then, rumors say that Big Ben, he wouldn't just accept any artist, even if they had money. you would listen to what they had first before you record. Unlike producers of today, maybe if I've got my man, I can just record anyway, tell them about it.
That is the industry standard. You've got to audition, you've got to understand the group. So, yes, way back we used to go. There's no part of Zimbabwe that I haven't been to. Just audition, looking for talent, scouting, you know what I mean? And we sit there on the farms, mines, you know, beer holes and stuff like that with guys. And they would play and they would perform and we would work the music together, you know, edit this, edit that out, edit that, you know, and until we're happy that the music is good enough to record, then only then would we book them. Well, unlike these days, things, of course, like you said, things have changed. Yeah. And of course, the state of the economy as well, it affects a lot of people. And so everyone is after money now. So sometimes, well, people just tend to, as long as you've paid your money, I'll record whatever you want. And that sort of brings sort of like some of a deterioration in quality of music that's being recorded. Sometimes when I listen to some of this music, I just wonder, hey, is this actually being played on air? You know, some of it is really bad. And others are doing a great job. Yeah.
Tom, how was it like to work with Dr. Thomas Mafumo?
Dr. Thomas Mafumo, that was my early stages. I was still training then when I was with Dr. Thomas Mafumo. I learned a lot from him. He was much more mature. And to tell you the truth, I never understood the traditional music before. But he taught me through his music and the way he worked and started appreciating that style of music. And he was a nice guy too. He was very free. And, relaxing, jocular, you know what I mean? You laugh and go out and have lunch and stuff like that. So we're like a family unit. So it helps in the production because you understand what you need to do is to understand what the artist is trying to do. You as an engineer or producer and try and bring it forward electronically, you know what I mean? Yeah.
We can also talk of Marshall.
Yes. Marshall was very interesting. Marshall was a very shy guy. Even in the studio, you know, when we were doing this, after we've done the recording of the instruments, it's time to do the vocals. Marshall would go in there and would ask us to switch off the lights in the studio. He wanted to sing in the dark. He didn't want people to look at him, and you know, and he would sing very well. Sometimes we'd hide his mic behind in a blind corner where we can't see him. You just hear his voice. And if somebody walks into the control room, somebody who's got nothing to do with the session, Marshall would just talk. Because he didn't want any foreign bodies in his session, you know what I mean? Which is fair, because it's not nice. When you're creating something, you don't want spectators, you know what I mean? If you're creating a baby, you don't want spectators to watch you, you know what I mean? If you're in the loo, you don't want spectators. So that's the same thing in a recording studio. It's a very private, it's a personal thing. So Marshall would actually stop until we finish with this guy, and then he would continue from where I left off.
You know, we can't talk of legends when we leave Leonard Nimmo, you know. Even yes. After now, even in weddings, we can dance to his music. Yes. Tell me about it.
Yes, Leonard Nimmo was a very, very good songwriter and arranger. Although he didn't want a lot of publicity, though, like in videos, newspapers and stuff. He was very reserved, much more like I do, and rather. I prefer staying behind the scenes. And Leonard was almost like that. But it's hard if you're an artist and if you're a public artist. So circumstances force you to when you go on stage, it's already public, you know what I mean? People take photos and all those sort of things. So, but yes, he was very interesting guy to work with. He was very creative. And I used to work very well with his band members as well in the studio. They understood each other.
You know what, we are here because of the big artist that this man was behind. So after the break, we'll continue talking about main artists yesterday with Jonathan. Gearing up for a session is what I'm doing right here in the studio with a man who has produced for more than 100 artists. Can you imagine? And of the 100 artists, some of them are legends of today. You can mention of any artist who's big in the industry. We talk of both Onyamwendera. How was it like to work with Oliver Mtukudzi?
Well, I was actually very privileged to have worked with him from the time he was a nobody and up to now. We still have very good relationship. We work together very well, and it was very enlightening. Because Olifant Tukunzi was like, he had resilience and he had patience, and he worked very hard. You know,
Simon Chimbetu.
Simon Chimbetu, yes. When I worked with Simon Chimbetu, he was coming from a different company. He'd already made his name. I only started working with him when he did this lullaby, you know, and things like that. Timekeeping was a bit, but he was all right. That's another very creative guy, you know, so I used to enjoy working with him.
Okay, and over Zimbabwe, Cha 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 Kings.
Yes, yes, those are bands of the 80s and 90s. Mm. They were very big then, and mostly we used to do 7 singles, and they were a very good band.
Kiama Boys.
It's Kiama. I started with it from the beginning, and until they split up, Alec Machis went out. And also a very, very creative band, and a very interesting. They came out with their own style, which is being followed. Basically, that's what everybody's playing right now.
I'm getting tired, but I'll still ask System Tajida.
When I first heard System Tajida singing, that voice sort of struck me like, hey, what kind of voice is that? Because he was totally different.
Oh.
Yeah, so when he did Mabawa with Kiama Boys.
Mabawa and Dide.
Yeah, before he joined, before he formed his own band, the Chazisa Challengers. That's when I heard that, this voice is unique, you know what I mean? And we went on to record that Mabawa, and it was a huge success. And I don't know what happened, but he left Kiama later and joined his own, formed with his own band. And we worked together from there on.
Then there is Njerema Boys as well.
Yes, Njerema Boys from Muzarabani. The first time I went to audition them, that was during that, I can't remember what year it was, we had the Cyclone Eileen. Remember?
I do.
The floods, yeah. So I went to Muzarabani Center. I was supposed to meet them at some school off the center. People told me that if you go there, you get stuck because people are being airlifted by helicopters because there's too much. So as I was coming back to Harare, I saw these guys coming with their own guitars. I thought, no, these are the guys. I was driving out of the center. And we went under a baobab tree, and they started playing their own music, and we fixed a few things. And I said, right, you're not ready yet. I'll come back. Just go and correct this, do this, do this, do this. When you're ready, just give me a shout again. I'll come back, I'll drive, I'll never get tired. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, and I went back, and then second time, they were successful. They started recording.
Okay. Yeah. Then there is a Solona Muta hitmaker.
Yes,
Solona Muta.
Although he was still working, he was being produced by Tony Rivett. I worked with him on his later albums. Yes, Jonah Moyo was another dedicated musician. And he was a very good songwriter, and his music was very popular. And it was very easy to work with. Yeah.
Okay, so the list is just endless.
It is endless. Yeah.
But maybe you just want to tell me about one person, Alec Macheso.
Yeah.
Maybe the talent. How do you see the talent as one student who has passed through? And
I see Alec is very, very talented. He never stops creating. He's got so many ideas. Some of them you have to curtail him and say no. It's a bit too much. You know what I mean? You've got to progress slowly. You can't just do this all of a sudden. You know what I mean? But he's very creative. And I understand now he's doing a new album with one of these youngsters. You know what I mean? So I'm looking forward to that, to hear what they're going to come up with.
Yeah. Well, the list is just endless. If you want to hear more of these legends and artists that both Onya Mondera has worked with, go to our Facebook page, Like Us, You Love Us, and you see the legends that he has worked with. Maybe want to round up because time is not on our side. Maybe do you have anything that you want to say to the upcoming musical producers so that they can be where you are right now?
Yeah, I know times are hard and things are difficult, and but you've got to have passion for the job, and of course earn money in so doing. And I'd like them to be more sort of selective in what they record, and try and advise the artists. Don't just accept anything they bring. Maybe take it and rearrange it, re-edit it, take out some things, put in some things which are more useful to the country and to the people. And I think they'll do well. Yeah.
Well, so anyone you would like to pay tribute to, that if it wasn't for who and who, I wouldn't be where I am right now.
Well, I'll pay tribute to the
guys at Shade Studios, like Steve Roskilly, Martin Norris, Steve Hughes, they actually gave me the opportunity to start working in the studio. I never had any idea how it was to sit behind there. I've always been in the studio, being the artist, you know, doing advertising jingles. But now, when they offered me the job, it opened up floodgates. There's a talent I didn't know I had, you know what I mean? So they gave me that opportunity to showcase it, and I appreciate them very much.
The producer of Buthu Nyamwendera is a legend indeed, who has managed to shape up Zimbabwe music into what it is today. Unfortunately, we have come to the end of an exciting, informative and educative episode of The Legends. So I must go. So till meet again next time. Goodbye and God bless.
Tenda uroi.